DJ.
This brings us down to the last session on the 10 states of God. Let's look at this. The 10 states of God, the ninth part of God Speaks on the 10 states of God represents what is probably the most important synoptic account of Meher Baba's philosophy, or I've been using the word darshana. This final session will be devoted to review of this most key chapter when God Speaks. And I thought we would finish the very end with part 10, which is a one-page, the genre with which I associated is called a palinode. We'll get to that later on. But I wanted actually to begin just by saying, begin where we had left off, saying a little more about they're called the five presences, that's a term that's used. This concept derives explicitly from Ibn Arabi, the great Sadhguru, the great Qutb of Islam, who died about 1240, but it's been presented as a very universal kind of a concept that can be found in a number of the great spiritual traditions, and it's inherent in what Baba has given us. And also, it appears very visibly in chart 11, as I'll try to show you in a second. But these, the five presences, what the idea of the word presence is, that God is always present. In fact, God alone is present. If you're a gross conscious soul, God is present to you as the gross sphere. If you're the gross sphere, the alami nasut, that would be the presence of God through that modality. If you're a subtle conscious, God is present, the alami malakut. These terms will come up in God Speaks. You'll find them in the supplement and other places. And by the way, in the glossary to God Speaks, you'll find these explained. And in the revised sixth edition, there's more. The glossary to that, there's more on these terms. If ever you want to look up some of this vocabulary in there. So to the subtle conscious soul, God is present through the subtle sphere, the alami malakut. In the mental sphere, it's the alami jabarut. Now these would all be within the domain of creation, right? The mental, subtle, and gross sphere. But now we cross into the God sphere. God as divinity possessed of attributes and form, sagun and sakar. John, you brought up these terms the other day, but we never really talked about them. Sagun means sa, S-A-H, with, and gun means attributes. If you've ever read the Bhagavad Gita or any from the school of thought called Samkhya, you'd hear about the gunas, the three gunas. Are you acquainted, any of you, with the three gunas? There's sattva, rajas, and tamas. It's related to Ayurvedic medicine and many other things. It's a big river there. Those would be the three attributes of that school of philosophy. So God with attributes is sah plus gun, and God without attributes, nir and gun, without attributes. Now, it is only by virtue of God's attributes that we can have any approach or any relationship to God at all. If God without attributes is completely inconceivable and unapproachable to us.
Is it contradictory to call it one of God's presences? If it's without attributes and it's inconceivable and indescribable?
Well, if you're there, it's present to you then. To a majub, to cha-cha.
Okay, so from the perspective of
one is there, to that modality, yeah. No, it's a good question. So, nirgun and sagun, you'll see these, they come up a lot in infinite intelligence, and you'll also see them in God Speaks. And they're big terms within Vedanta. And under other language, you'll see these concepts all over the place in Christian thought of the great theologians of the Middle Ages, Aquinas and people like that, and in Islamic thought too. In Islamic thought, it is only through the attributes, sifat is the word that gets used. You'll see these in some of those charts in God Speaks that have the Vedantic Sufi and Christian terms. Sifat is the term used for attributes. It is only through God's attributes that God can be even conceived or known at all. Like God's beauty would be an attribute, or God's mercy, or the 99 names of God are various, a lot of them are various attributes of God. Without the attributes of God, God can only be talked about in negative terms. God is not this, God is not that. Sometimes they'll talk in philosophy, theology, apophatic approaches to God. That means purely negative. God can only be approached by dissociating God from all the things that he is not. That would be the nearest. You know, this is probably related to the impersonal side of God. God is an infinite ocean, which really speaking we cannot imagine. So these would be the five presences of God according to this
Would you say that the everything is number one and all the other ones are the nothing? Or am I trying to put something over the top that doesn't matter?
I think this too would belong to the domain of the everything in relationship to the nothing, though. I wish we could go into Ibn Arabi. His explanation of this is really quite amazing.
Maybe the first one is the real nothing and God is...
I think it's the everything. I think it's the everything in and of itself. But without a face. God without a face. You know, there was the topic of Barzakh. I remember Mani saying, but Baba had said, God is an infinite ocean, infinite shoreless ocean. But how do you get into that infinite shoreless ocean if there's no shore? So the avatar is a shore. And that is the person, Sagun, the avatar, the tenth state of God is Sagun, has attributes, various modalities of relationship. Are you wanting to say?
When Baba says, when the pilgrim is realized, two stages, the first stage is Fana,
yeah,
which is divine vacuum, which are equates with the beyond state of God.
Yeah.
Then it's followed by Fana Fana, which is the everything.
But I don't think this would necessarily, yeah. Okay. It's a complex question. It would be take a lot of unpacking. Maybe actually, yeah. So I better dodge it until after the session's over. But when we were earlier talking about Al-Ansan Al-Kamil, the perfect man, or the Sadhguru would be that, and the avatar also would be that. These are the five we were just looking at, okay? Just, right, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These are kind of terms for it that would be familiar to us as Baba lovers. These are basically the same five, and this is all we can skip. So, but the Al-Ansan Al-Kamil is the bridge, the link that links everything, all five of those from the top to the bottom. And the Insan al-Kamal is the only one who does that, who spans from top to bottom. Otherwise, there's no link. So in a lot of the Islamic Sufi high theology, or whatever you call that, this, in fact, it's very, very central in Ibn Arabi and others. And it begins to sound like the avatar. And I think in our context, we can just say it's the avatar of the perfect master, or it's the tenth state of God. And now there are a bunch of, I just wanted to draw your attention. Where are you? Sorry, I blinked out. Yes, this is one of the last chart in God Speaks. It's this one. I know, redundant to show it to you, because I'm sure you all remember, have memorized it, just to call it quickly back to mind. It's this one here, the back of the book, in the second edition. It wasn't there in the first. This was created by Lud Dimphel and was sent to Baba, and he approved it for inclusion in the second edition of God Speaks, published in 1973. And it's actually, I think it's quite excellent. I'm quite impressed by what Lud did. It's actually very helpful. But just to look at one quadrant of it, this isn't the quadrant, it's this side. Okay, you can see here the first manifestation, the second manifestation, and then down below, the third manifestation, the fourth manifestation, the fifth manifestation, things like that. These are actually the same five that we were just looking at. There a number of these, in fact, correlate to this group of five I was just talking about, the five presences. If we took an hour or two to study it, we could really bring that out, what that's about. And in one of the parts of the supplement, it's item 34 in the supplement, it's on the subject of Tauhid. What is Tauhid? Remember that?
Unity.
Unity. It's the often said to be the central doctrine of Islam, which is the unity of God. That's why they're critical of Christians, because the Christians have come up with a trinity. God is not three but one. So in that section by Tauhid, which was almost assuredly written by Dr. Ghani, he goes over a lot of these things, and he goes over what I'm calling the five presences. They're not called that there, but that's what they are. This is actually related to the 10 states of God, which is our topic today. Now, so then, there are coming into what I can call, let's see, where did I put all this? Some adumbrations of the 10. This is some of the prehistory of it. Oops, I didn't put it in here. Okay, I'll get it in a minute. But the 10 states of God seems to me to be Baba's master formulation of his cosmology, as much as there is one single such account. This would be my pick. This is the chart we're talking about. And it seems that the chart was the first part of God Speaks to have been written by Baba, unless there was earlier material given to Dr. Ghani. But when in 1952, there was talk about how he brought a chart and was going to write a book exploring it. So even though this chapter comes right at the end of the book, it appears to have been the germ from which the whole book grew. And when we get to this chapter, we've gotten to the third pass. Remember this idea of the three passes through the divine theme? You know, the divine theme is that story of the journey of the soul from the whim of God through evolution, reincarnation, involution to realization. And I'm calling that a pass. So chapters 2 to 7 go through it the first time. And chapter 8, that very long chapter, went through it the second time, in the course of which Baba brings up all this cosmic architecture, you know, the wakefulness, dream, sound, sleep, creator, preserver, destroyer, knowledge, power, bliss, fana, baka, the spiritual hierarchy, all these other topics come up as perennial factors, perennial elements, constituents in the makeup of the universe. So the second pass through the divine theme engages those topics and explains them, which Baba doesn't explain at all in the first time through. But now this is the third pass through the divine theme. And what is, it's very, very clear now. A lot of points are made clear, which were just hinted at earlier. And also, I'm struck by the fact that there are states. A narrative has been reinterpreted or transformed in the understanding to perennial states of an eternal God. So the story has, you see, stories are actually all in the imagination. Stories never happen because nothing ever happens. There's no time, there's no space. And Baba has presented it as a story until now. But at this stage, it's as if you're transcending the story and becoming eternal states of God. At least that's how it looks to me. This is my own understanding of it. Do you have any thoughts or any takes on this topic? Three great passes through the divine theme seem to be the main structure and the organization of God Speaks, as far as I can see. And this is the third. So, this chart is another telling of the divine theme, as a matter of fact. That's what it is. And now, Baba had been approaching this topic again and again throughout the years. And I'll just give one example of it, and that is an infinite intelligence. He's constantly saying, there are three stages, there are two stages, there are three states, there are four states. And his most extensive formulation of, his fullest formulation of it in God Speaks. This is an early approach to the topic of the 10 states of God. But in infinite intelligence, he talks about the unthinking infinite intelligence. Here, infinite intelligence plays the part neither of creating the universe, nor of realizing the universe, nor realizing itself. He's describing this in terms of creating and realizing his theme of infinite intelligence. But what does this remind you of any particular state of God? The beyond beyond state. Yeah, before creation. The infinite mind. Here, infinite intelligence plays the part of creating, preserving, and destroying the subtle and gross universe, while at the same time realizing neither its creation nor itself. What about this?
Ishwar.
This is Ishwar. And for those of you acquainted with the ten states of God, which one would this be?
The third
state of God. Emanator, sustainer, and dissolver. I think that's what they're called there. The most finite false mind, that is the most finite subtle and gross mind. Subtle means subtle plus mental in infinite intelligence. Here, infinite intelligence plays the part of realizing the subtle and gross universe most finitely and most imperfectly. What is this?
State four,
which is the embodied soul. Yeah. Now we have the principle of embodiment. In infinite intelligence lingo, we call this thinking the imagination. Now, the jivatma has begun to identify itself with forms of the imagination. And most finite, which of the kingdoms do you imagine that best applies itself to?
Stone,
yeah, the beginning.
The word force is a big question. Because human evolution is, only human mind is force, isn't it? Force thinking? The evolutionary stages are just natural.
But they're in infinite intelligence thinking.
They're called force. Force mind.
The fourth state of God you're talking about?
No, he said, yeah, I know. But I read somewhere evolutionary species on the evolutionary journey still, they're not force mind. Because they don't have our natural sense stars. So they're just limited mind. Isn't it?
Oh, false. Oh, okay.
False.
Okay. 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 That is true. There is a statement like that. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's a refinement. I won't try to explain here. The less and less finite false mind. Yeah, he does call it false mind anyway, even though strictly speaking it's not. The less and less finite false mind, that is, the less and less subtle and gross, finite, subtle and gross mind. Here the infinite intelligence plays the part of realizing the subtle and gross universe less and less finitely and less imperfectly. Where do you suppose this is in our divine theme narrative?
In delusion.
No, it's actually still before that.
The animal kingdom?
The Really. Up from above stone, all the way up to the animal kingdoms. So less and less finitely, all the way up to the edge of monkey. Now we get the infinite false mind, that is the infinite subtle and gross mind. Here, infinite intelligence plays the part of realizing the subtle and gross universe infinitely and most perfectly. In this state, it plays the part neither of creating, preserving, destroying the universe, nor of realizing itself. By the way, that he's repeating the Ishwar function. Creating, preserving, and destroying the universe is done only by Ishwar, not by us. Who would this be? Human form. Ordinary, gross, conscious human beings. And the infinite real mind, here infinite intelligence, plays the part of realizing itself. In this state, it plays the part neither of creating, preserving, and destroying the universe, nor of realizing the universe. Who would this be?
Sadhguru or Vibhu?
Is it a Sadhguru?
No, beyond.
Why not? A Sadhguru creates, preserves, and destroys the universe. He encompasses the third state of God. This would be a Majum.
But I thought the infinite intelligence, Baba says somewhere that the perfect master doesn't perform the rule, play the role of creating and preserving.
He says that of a Sadhguru,
yeah.
And that's because sometimes he uses the Sadhguru to mean a Majum.
Yeah.
And when we were working on this, we found this chart. I know it's hard to see. This was found independently of infinite intelligence, this little packet that Marilyn and Jessawala had. And you may notice 1, 3, 2, there's a 4 here, there's a 5 here, and there's a 6 here. And those correspond exactly to the 6 we were just looking at. And that cinched it, that this chart was representing what we just read. Of that series of 6 things. This is the master chart for infinite intelligence. So for infinite intelligence, Baba came up with the 6 states of God, basically. But now the 10 states of God is the heart and soul of this session will be to look at them closely. So let's look at the chart first. Okay, so the divine theme flows like this. It starts here, it zooms off that way, like that, comes like this, and then it goes up to here. And that's actually the completion of the divine theme.
Well, the divine theme doesn't really talk about 3, it sort of skips right over that.
Doesn't talk about 3?
Don't you think?
No, that's actually true. And there are some contradictions in God Speaks because that point is not acknowledged. So, okay, the divine thing is zoom, like that. Yeah. And actually, the divine theme only takes you as far as God realization. But there is more to the story there. So the 10 states of God are, first, God in the beyond, beyond state. The original state of God that we were talking about yesterday. Now, here, God in the beyond state has 3 substates. And this is one of the most fascinating and beguiling and mind-boggling parts of the book. It has substate A, substate B, and substate C. And in brief, it's not really explained here, but what are these? We had a play at Mirabad 10 years ago, The Ten States of God. And it's too bad Jeanette's not here.
Oh, she
was
not turned up at any moment.
What's that? Oh, I see. Well, she was one of them.
Yes.
Actually, she was that one. That's Jeanette.
I think I remember David Bowie.
Who?
David
Bowie. David, were you in there? Weren't you there?
Yes. I think he did something very vulgar.
He was quite vulgar. He was in the middle of it. Yeah. See, I think you were substate A.
I think we had the urge.
You had the urge, yeah.
So would substate B really be realized God?
Yeah.
Substate B is God conscious knowing himself.
Yeah.
And substate A is infinite unconsciousness. God in the state of infinite unconsciousness. God in the state of infinite consciousness. And C is God in the state of infinite consciousness, conscious of himself as God, conscious of the creation also. So these are three substates, and the question being put to all of you for us to resolve for posterity is, how can these be three substates of one state when they completely contradict each other? Like God unconscious and God conscious. How ridiculous to put them in the same beyond state too. So Chris, do you have got an answer to that quickly?
Well, the presence of an apple is also the absence of an apple.
Wow. Okay, going Zen on us. Now, as I recall, David had a big bowel movement when he was and that's what gave rise to all of this. And Baba has actually said that that's what the creation. Baba, I remember, would say, have you seen the nice word Eric used, have you seen my excreta?
Mm.
And his excreta is this entire creation, so.
I think Baba said something like that when he was here, didn't he? Didn't he, when he was talking to the men or something?
In Avatar's Above, did he
I
say that?
I thought he did, I could be wrong.
Yeah.
I think I've heard from Eric Nadell that Baba told Patrick in the early days that I had an urge, you know, the whole creation came out. But there's a kick in it. It became a headache on me, but there's a kick in it.
So
Ward, before the whim, we can imagine there's only state one.
Right.
Right? And
right.
Then after the whim, the whole lot is there then.
That's right.
Because it's eternal, so it all just, the whole chart comes from one.
All comes out of it. And to anticipate what we'll be saying more of later, the entire journey of the soul, the entire divine theme, is to go from 2A to 2B. From God unconscious to God conscious. It's all that. So maybe, Jeff, when you do your presentation on Hamlet, we could have a new interpretation of to be or not to be. That is the question. And then the next state, now once we pass through, okay, the Om point is not. Any chart shows certain things and necessarily has to hide others. So we don't have the Om point on this chart. Actually, we don't have the Nirvana state talked about in the Ten States of God either. But
the Nirvana is the beyond the eye.
No, I don't think so.
Why is there no space?
It's because the beyond is not conscious and Nirvana is conscious.
So is it in the Nirvana state, the realized, so is infinitely conscious of the beyond state of God.
Yeah, but in the beyond state of God, you're not conscious of it. So, so coming out of 2A, what emerges first is God as emanator, sustainer, dissolver, state 3. And the in infinite intelligence, this is called what?
Ishwar.
An emanator is, what would be the name for that?
Creator.
What would a Hindu call it?
Brahma.
And how about sustainer?
Vishnu.
And how about dissolver?
Mahesh.
Mahesh, by the way, is another name of Shiva. Mahesh is actually Maha Ishwar. And devotees of Shiva would call him Ishwar, the Lord. So Maha Ishwar Mahesh is the name of Shiva. So they're the same, they mean the same thing. So this is a, now here's what, as maybe Paul was pointing out, what is actually a little bit confusing about this is that the Jivatma passes through all these other states, but actually the Jivatma never has that experience. That's an aspect of God who makes his appearance at this stage of the God. The Jivatma is never creator, preserver, destroyer. We were just reading this morning that after one cycle, maybe after Mahapralaya, the third state of God retires and gets a vacation. But it's not until then. Okay, if you want to see another picture of Jeanette,
yeah.
Here she is. Do you remember that? She sang a song about it, too.
Yeah.
I would know, having written the song.
Can you become like that now?
Or can you song more difference?
Or we sang a song about her. It's kind of like
three.
So now we've come through the whim pass, is actually one chart shows that is on that cusp between one and two. Now the actual journey of evolution begins with God as the embodied soul. And the question I'll ask presently and anticipate it now is, why is it a separate state of God when all of these are embodied souls? Isn't that redundant? Isn't Baba being rather redundant?
Couldn't it just be a thing?
But in that case, it's on the same level as these, which are also headings. God is the soul in the state of evolution.
Is it not just variations?
Evolution and human as well.
Mm. Yeah, that's right. I mean, this, God is a human embodied soul, goes all the way up to realization.
Is that like an archetypal thing for, rooting for the rest of it?
Yeah, it seems to me like Baba is enunciating a very fundamental principle there, the principle of embodiment. And it's one of the longest sections of the Ten States of God, and one of the most significant, actually. But then these are all the soul, after the embodiment has been established, what the embodied soul goes through. So it is that critical moment. Prana and Akash clash to get a form. A thinking identifies with the imagination and says, I'm that.
And the variations of that.
Yeah. Everything else is a variation or development on that fundamental principle of embodiment, which is what Baba really explains at length in that section.
Is that why you think that line's going off to the other way as well?
I think probably this was just to fit in all of these.
But see how there's a line that's got nothing on it. Like there's a line that goes to the right. And then there's the one that goes to the left. After God, go left.
Yeah, there.
Like, what's that line? I think it's sort of like brackets around. God as embodied soul takes all of that stuff underneath it there.
Probably right. I never thought of that.
In some sort of way, those other two, like five and six, are sort of substates of four in a way.
That makes a lot of sense. What do you all think? That is to say, this line is meaningful because there are lots of little circles on it, but this line seems not to be. Mm. So what Paul is saying is that means to denote the fact that all of these are embodied souls.
Mm.
That makes sense. Mm. I never thought of that before. Yeah. These charts are really worth studying. This, all this kind of thing. That's probably right.
Or you might have just made another line out there to balance the...
Yeah. Maybe it's unfinished. There was some other guys that we don't know.
Yeah, maybe he just drew it and said, it's too much trouble to erase it.
They didn't have a liquid paper.
Leave Paul will impute a significance to it.
That's right.
We've got ingenious people who will explain their way out of any box.
Crap artists, they're called.
So then we have, I know it's hard to see. In fact, I'll extend it since we're looking at it closely at the moment. Okay. Still is fuzzy. Sorry, I don't have radiant inches always. Stones, metals, vegetables, worms, fishes, birds, animals, humans. And he puts humans on this line. And I think the thought is the evolutionary process culminates there. That's the end, that's the goal of evolution, it achieves that. And in a number of places in this, the 10 states of God and other parts of God speaks, Baba speaks of leaps. And I think actually what the number 7 really refers to is 7 leaps. You come to the end of the stone form and you leap to metal. You come to the end of the metal form and you leap to vegetable. 7 movements like that. Okay, and then, so this is the end of the evolutionary descent. And consistently, not always, but almost always in his charts, Baba depicts evolution as a descent and involution as an ascent, climbing up again. And with, you know, God is in heaven above. I think there's a fundamental spatial orientation that comes with the human form. And there's an up-downness to this. Okay, so now we have God as a human soul in the state of reincarnation. So this is where you go through your 8,400,000 lifetimes. Unless, of course, you fall back to stone state and do it again. And now we have the 3 spheres, and we have another representation of the gross sphere here. By the way, what is this little S, you think?
The
Atma, the soul, yeah, which is at the core of it all the way through. And so now the Atma is experiencing the gross sphere in reincarnation, the subtle sphere, it's the colors here are too dark to read, the mental sphere here. So God in the state of spiritually advanced souls, that's the 7th state of God. And then, does somebody enter the highest divine consciousness? After, is that involution? Does somebody have the book?
After mental world, soul enters divine state of consciousness.
That's mental world. After mental world, soul enters highest divine consciousness. So then you go to the 8th state of God, God as divinely absorbed. I keep wishing that I had put into the slideshow the photograph of Cha-Cha from the Wayfarers. And he is a Majub. Baba worked with him a lot. And when you look at him, at least for me, I really get a strong feeling for what a Majub is. He's obviously quite conscious, and he's obviously not conscious of his environment at all. He's not seeing anything, but he is very, very vividly, acutely conscious. You can just see that looking at him. So what is a Majub conscious of?
This.
Actually, it's all 3, power, knowledge, and bliss. A Mukti gets bliss only, but a Majub is conscious of the triune nature of God. Power, knowledge, bliss. And the universe does not exist to them. And at this point, most jivatmas, this is the end. This is the goal. You achieve the goal of life. This is the where you experience the everything. And the nothing, it does not exist for you. But for a small number of souls, the journey continues, where you go from the 8th state of God onto the 9th state of God. And what's the 9th state of God? That's the 10th. Here we
get
a Jivanmukta or a Paramhansa. Those 2 would be the 2 main types. There's actually a Salik. Azad and Afghan, it's in the chart for different categories. But the characteristic of those in the 9th state of God is that they're infinite, they're God conscious, the I am God state. And they are also conscious of the creation. They have the final fana phila. What is fana phila?
Fana
phiala. And what does that mean?
Final annihilation in Allah.
Yeah, fana in other.
So fana fila. And for the people in the ninth state of God, they experience vaka bila. Fana means annihilation in God, that's the state. And vaka bila means abiding with God. So vaka is an abiding. When you pass into a plane or when you pass into an estate, the first stage is fana, the annihilation of what was. And once that annihilation has been accomplished, you abide in the new state, whatever it may be. So Baba uses Bhakavila for, after that annihilation, if you return to abiding in the created world, if you're conscious of it, then you experience Bhakavila. So these are two very useful terms. I know they're a bit of a mouthful, until you get used to them. Ila is Allah. So fi Allah, bi Allah. That's where those come from. Baka bila. So in the ninth state of God, you're in baka bila. You're conscious of the creation. So why aren't you a sadguru? What is missing?
You don't have a job.
You don't have a job. Yeah. You just get to hang out and watch it all.
Sounds good.
There's a school of opinion that thinks that's the best of the three.
You're just watching the TV.
Yeah. Yeah, I always think of that movie, Being There, by, you remember Chauncey Gardner?
Yeah.
And he says, I like to watch.
Yeah, that's right.
So he's destined to be in the ninth state of God. Although he became president, I think, so he wound up getting pushed into the top post anyway. But so that's the state where you're infinitely conscious. And actually, there are several categories of these. A paramhansa, I don't know if you remember that. Maybe we're not supposed to quote such politically, but there's a song, A Woman is a Sometime Thing, you know, that by Gershwin in Porgy and Bess, famous song. Well, a paramhansa is a sometime thing. Sometimes he's conscious of creation and sometimes not, off and on.
So he's got a remote, he can turn the TV on and off.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. But the other category in the ninth state of God is the Jivan Mukta. And the Jivan Mukta is always conscious of the creation.
He also has a duty to make one person come in.
Give realization to one, whereas the Paramahansa doesn't do that. By the way, Ramakrishna was called Ramakrishna Paramahansa, but he was not a Paramahansa in Baba's sense. He was a sadguru, he was a perfect master. He was Paramahansa-like, though, because he seemed to bliss out with some regularity.
So would the sadhak be in that state too? The sadhak would be in that state too?
You would say that they are have salukiyat. They're in a salic state in that they're conscious of the universe. That would be true.
I think the salic become jiva mukta. Paramhansa sometimes a maju sadik, sometimes called sadik maju, depending on whether they are more mad or less.
There's a funny story of someone in the ninth state of God in Tiffin lectures about Balul. I don't know if you remember any of your stories about Balul. Erich used to tell.
Is it the mango?
Huh?
The mango one on the knee. Balul had to suck the juice of the mango.
No, that's somebody else. That's actually Ramdas.
He had one in the discourse. Remember there's a story? He shaved his head.
Yeah, shaved his head.
I saw the prince.
There's another story Erich would tell of creating palaces in heaven.
That's right. Yeah.
Beautiful story.
Yeah.
Well, here's one that Baba tells. I don't know, maybe I'll be, I was criticized the other day for going down into the lower echelon. So to stuff your ears here, your modesty. Baba said that Balul, he was supposed to be the king, but because he became, you know, Majub, I think it was Majub Salik, or one of those things, and wasn't fit for the job, so his brother took it over. So his brother was in a Majub improvement program. He wanted to make him a bit better. And the best way to do that, since he was so out of it, was, of course, to get him married, right? So he did that. And so he created a beautiful bridal chamber for Balu. And so they're in the bed together the first night, and Balul puts his ear on his wife's organ and says, "What's this that I hear? What's all this noise? Somebody wants milk, somebody wants toys, somebody wants this, somebody wants that. Who's going to give it to them? I'm not going to have anything to do with this." So he wouldn't have anything to do with his wife. Yeah. So this is what happens if you marry a mushroom. It actually is a good expression of the state. They won't take on responsibility for anything. But the tenth state of God, represented by people like Jeanette, she was swinging from the roof up in a circle position. This was the roof of, I don't know if you've been to the theater, Mirabad, and so everything was hanging from the roof. David was, what, 15 feet in the air?
Yeah.
There. How was it to hang up there for an hour and a half?
It was hot.
And we had to devise strategies, you know.
Yeah.
How to drink enough liquid to be able to sustain ourselves in the heat but not have to get off that perch for 2 hours.
It would never do to have, you know, your sadhguru get down.
Deep meditation.
I think Roxanne was up here.
Yes.
She was in the state. So this is the tenth state of God, which, as we were saying this morning, is God as man-God and God-man, that is, as perfect master and his avatar, both. This is the office of both of them, apparently. They're not differentiated in this chart in these various ways. So this is the 10 states of God in a nutshell. So let's start looking at them a little bit more. By the way, this was written by Erich. Erich is the nominal author of this section on the Ten States of God. So,
but Baba would have looked over it.
Baba must have given him the whole thing. I don't know. I mentioned the other day that Gary Kleiner informed Erich that he was the author of this chapter. And Erich didn't know what on earth he was talking about. And then Erich brought him the book and showed his name on it, which he didn't know. And Erich just said, "Mine was the hand that wrote." You know, I bet you there really wasn't much of any difference between how this chapter was composed and how the others were. But anyway, he's the author of record for this section of the book. Why don't we read some of this? Anyone feeling sleepy? The beyond, beyond state. You know. We were thinking of having someone like, for our 10 states of God's, someone like Erico up in the, sleeping up in the top bed. But he wasn't willing to do it. Anyone?
The state.
Oh, okay. Go ahead.
God is the beyond, beyond state. This state of God is so transcendent that nothing can really be conceived of it. It is utterly pure and immaculate and has no tinge or otherness. It is the hidden of all hidden knowledge and the internal of all internal realities. It is beyond all words, and so it cannot be adequately described. It is neither finite nor infinite, neither attributeless nor with attributes. In this domain, the wings of thought, interference, discrimination, and understanding are limp and useless. Now,
you probably can't read the Persian. Yeah. Could you read the Persian?
No, I just
can't. Yeah. It would
be nice if you could. Anybody Persian movies.
So, that's the translation I'll read.
Yes.
He cannot be grasped by the mind. Therefore, do not exert yourself to understand him. He is free of all directions. Therefore, do not try to seek him anywhere.
Yeah.
Mahat Baba says that when one who has realized the state of God tries to describe it to others, this act results in a description not of the first, but of the second state of God, God in the beyond state.
So you really can't talk about it at all. So right now we're really talking about God in the beyond state, because the first state of God is inconceivable completely. You know, earlier we mentioned nirgun and sagun, those words. Perfect man has got to light the dust here. Nirgun and sagun. Also nirakar
and sakar.
And sakar. Nirgun is without attributes, and sagun is with attributes. Well, this is neither with attributes nor without attributes. You can't characterize it either way. So it can be talked about only in purely negative terms, to say what it is not. It is impossible to say what it is. And, you know, in informal usage in the Baba world, we often say that it's unconscious, but if you read through this closely, that's really not true either. It's neither conscious nor unconscious. You can't describe it in those terms either. There's simply no description at all. However, what is our basis for knowing about it, apart from reading God Speaks? Have you ever been there?
Sleep.
Every night. It sounds.
Could it also mean what? That God is without any form, without any attributes. That's nirakar, but complete in himself. That's sakar. So he doesn't need a form or attribute to be complete. He's just complete. He's God.
Yes, but he's not even without form in this state. The question cannot even be posed. He's neither with form nor without form. No description is true.
No wonder he said she randomly was.
So the Native American, the great mystery, describes.
Yeah. In Islam, the term, I forget, is it wara or wara, but they'll call it the dark mist. That's what it gets applied to the state of God. Yeah.
Later in that passage, Baba does qualify that by calling it the divine, infinite divine vacuum. A little bit later.
Mm. Yeah, second, end of the
last paragraph. This I always suspect is the Nirvana state that the Lord Buddha pointed to, which Nagarjuna describes. He used the same kind of negative thing, neither this nor that.
Well, that's true, but Baba says that the Nirvana state, it's the only state of God in which God is not, but consciousness is.
Yeah.
He says that about it. But that's not true of this state. There's no consciousness either.
Well, that's the realized state, the Nirvana. It's talking from the angle of realization.
Yeah, but it's not the beyond state. When you're in Nirvana, you're not in the beyond because you're conscious.
We'll fix that tomorrow.
So, let's see, what else? Yeah, this state is referred to by the Sufis as Wara Urwara. The beyond state of God. Vedanta calls it Paratpar Parabrahma. So God is neither nirguna, without attributes, nor saguna, with attributes. And this word is a big one. I haven't been using it yet, but nirakar. Do you know what akar is?
Form. Akar means form.
A form.
A shape.
So nir akar means without form. And sakar, it's S-A-H, means with. Sakar means with form. You'll see a lot of this in God Speaks, but especially in Infinite Intelligence. So the formless God would be nirakar. Nirakar Brahman or nirakar Paramatma, or the nirakar intelligence, as Baba in Infinite Intelligence calls it. But it's not even nirakar, it's not even formless. You can't even describe it that way. It's indescribable. There's no character. No thought can penetrate, no distinction, no understanding can begin to penetrate to where the state is. So it's neither nirakar nor sakar. One might be inclined to say that it's formless without attributes, but that's not true of the beyond beyond state. Okay, it's the most original, and he says later that the beyond state of God is the original state of God, but this is the most original. So we have this use of most that he starts getting into there. It's the divine vacuum, Tan, as you're pointing out. It's the unbounded, absolute, infinite divine vacuum. Let's see if there's anything else. Yeah. Thus, the most original beyond beyond state of God is that state where one can only say, God is eternally. And that, in this most original state, God is neither infinitely nor finitely conscious. You can't say that God is infinitely conscious. You can't say that God is finitely conscious. And you can't say that God is unconscious. So actually, sound sleep, that state, rigorously speaking, is not unconscious. It's neither conscious nor unconscious. There's no description that is true of it. Of self or of his own state of infinitude, in the state, God is also neither conscious nor unconscious of the illusion or reality. So this most original, most primordial state of God eludes all description. In fact, in the beginning of the next one, Baba says precisely that. We have already stated that the beyond beyond state of God can never be adequately described. God realized beings, when they try to describe the beyond beyond state, succeed only in describing the beyond state of God, which is the Allah of Sufis, the Ahura Mazda of Zoroastrians, the Paramatma of Vedantists, God the Father of Christians, and the Oversoul some philosophers. Okay. So now, as far as I know, this distinction, let's just flash back to the chart to remind ourselves of where we are. So this is the beyond state. And now we're coming into the beyond state. And this is distinguished by its having three substates. And I find this to be one of the really amazing discussions in God Speaks. And so far as I know, this distinction between the beyond state and the beyond state, states one and states two, came late in Baba's life. He had not enunciated. What do you think, Chan? Are you seeing it before? Because I haven't. I'm conscious of it. I heard in 1952 he had explained it to some people in India, and there are some indications he may have explained it to Dr. Ghani back in 1947. Remember when Ghani was, Baba was dictating material to Ghani, and the lazy bum couldn't get the work done back in the, got a valet, and even that wasn't enough for him to get his work done. Baba, it appears, gave him the distinction then, but it really appears for the first time in God Speaks in chapter 8, the long chapter 8. And here it comes up in a big way. And I think it's one of the, I don't know, another of the great ideas in God Speaks, the way he explains this differentiation between states 1 and states 2. And one of the points he makes several times is that state one and state two, those states are actually identical. But the only thing that differentiates them is the substates of A, B, and C. And on the face of it, that's one hell of a differentiation, because state one is God unconscious, state two is God conscious. How can they be the same state of God? It seems like an impossible contradiction, does it not? And yet, they are all actually the same state of God. So part, a lot of, and then the third one is God conscious, but conscious of creation also. In state B, God is unconscious of creation. In state C, God is conscious of creation. And the second state of God is all three of those at the same time. How can those be a single state of God? So that's part of what Baba is going to be talking about here. Now, here's some of what he says about this. Let's see. Okay. Yeah, this is where he said, okay. You hear Baba, while explaining the second state of God, stressed that fundamentally state two is in no way different from state one of God. The substates A, B, and C of state two of God are what create the difference. Okay. And then, now he starts to explain this, and this is quite a, an amazing explanation. Somebody read some of this out?
Yes, at the instant, how, when, and where the difference came into being is described as follows from the explanations of Mahabharata. At the instant when the latent, original, infinite whim of the infinite God to know himself, who am I, is about to surge in the unbounded uniformity of the unbounded, absolute, infinite, divine vacuum of the most original beyond, beyond state of God. The very prospect of this infinite urge to know, prompting the eternally tranquil poise of God in the unbounded, absolute, infinite divine vacuum, becomes inconceivable.
Okay, so the prospect of the whim, when it's about to happen, the prospect becomes inconceivable. Okay, so naturally it happens. God is a two-year-old. No, if it's inconceivable, it's going to happen. That's right. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Okay, let me keep going.
But the fact of the insurge of the infinite wind and its very inconceivability spontaneously brings into being another aspect of God's state, other than the most original beyond beyond state of unbounded, absolute, infinite divine vacuum.
And this is that first state of God again that he's describing.
Where there is neither prospect of aspect nor attribute, neither the infinite or finite consciousness, nor the infinite or finite unconsciousness, and where, except for the infinity of God, which is eternally manifest, every other thing is latent, including the infinite whim and the consequent infinite urge to know.
So all this is describing the beyond beyond state, okay, out of which it comes. Keep going.
Thus it is that the very inconceivability of the prospect of the infinite whim surging in the beyond beyond state automatically unfolds the prospectiveness.
What is prospectiveness?
Actually is about to be.
Yeah. An orientation towards, a looking towards, a sort of an anticipation. The fact that it's inconceivable precipitates a perspectiveness towards it as the other state that the inconceivability gives rise to.
Apples are not apples again.
Huh?
Apples are not apples again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. He's going to give an analogy for that later on in this, with a fetus in a womb. A fantastic analogy. I'm going to keep going. We got stopped on perspectiveness.
Which is also latent in the infinite state. And this manifestation of prospectiveness
bestows upon the most original beyond state of God the prospect of an infinite aspect different from that of the most original and eternal state.
I don't know, are you guys getting this at all? It's very sublime what he's describing. Because the instant it's about to happen, it's absolutely inconceivable that any such thing could happen within the infinite, indivisible poise and stillness of the beyond state. But because it's inconceivable, that gives rise to another aspect of perspectiveness towards that very thing. And it is out of that that the wind does arise.
The second state of God, accordingly, comes into being only as another infinite aspect of the most original first state. This second state of the ten principal states of God is called the original beyond state of God.
Okay, let's keep reading.
It is to be heeded well that this original second state of God, denoted in the chart as two, and termed God in beyond state, is in no way to be taken as a state of God altogether other than the most original first state of God, denoted in the chart as one, and termed God in beyond state. The only difference between state one and state two of God is that state one is of unbounded, absolute, infinite, divine vacuum, where even the remotest prospect of the insurge of the infinite wind is inconceivable.
By the way, have you ever seen this word before, insurge? Yeah. What do you think it means? An insurge.
Well, it's when there's a lot of power exerting on something, and suddenly there is an inlet created, and that power surges in. It's an insurge of power.
Surging inwards rather than surging out.
Yeah. Mm. Or else, when there's a type of vacuum that is open to be filled with something.
Yes, an insurge into a vacuum. Yeah, there's a... I never thought of that either.
It's like it's drawn in if there's a vacuum.
Yeah. Doesn't it mean that there's a surge coming from within? Like an insurgent force is coming from within the country.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Like, I think he's using it like that. So it doesn't come from somewhere else, because there isn't anything else. It somehow kind of bubbles from within. There's
also
a surge within
it's a surging that goes within, because there's nowhere out to go. Nothing else actually exists. Yeah. So he's trying to use this language to keep insisting on that we really can't understand this. You know, my image is all this is happening in some kind of an ocean. That's sort of picture in my mind. But again, there's no space in this ocean, and there's no space where it could possibly be happening. So, okay.
But it's also perhaps an interesting use of terminology, because it's talking about the urge within that word.
Mm. Mm. Yeah. Is there a word insurge? I mean, we've heard insurgents.
There it is.
Well,
I've never heard the word insurge before.
No, but a friend of mine made knife handles, and the way that he used to do it was he would put the wood into a bottle of oil, and he would create a vacuum, and the vacuum would draw all the moisture out of the wood, and so it would bubble up, and then he would release the vacuum, and the wood would suck up the oil.
Huh.
Where all of the moisture was,
I see.
The oil would be sucked up. So there, I can see that could be described as an insurge. In that where there was a vacuum. And it speaks of the divine vacuum.
Yeah, that's nice. It's a nice figure for this. Yeah. Where were we? We were reading...
Therefore, only at the instant when the original infinite whim insurges in the infinitude of the God is state, could infinite God conceive the infinite original urge to know as who am I? That is, only when the aspectless state one of God in beyond beyond gets the aspect of state two of God in beyond, parat parabrahma, thus gets the infinite aspect of paramatma.
Okay, so now these are terms for states one and state two. Do you know, when I read this, I spent my whole life in writing and things like that, and I read this and I think, how did Baba come up with this topic, for heaven's sakes? You know, of course, Dean God helps. But I would never have dreamed, even thought of this whole subject area to begin with. But how the possibility of the whim could even arise. He's been explaining that as the basis for the distinction between these two states. Just to jump a little bit here, out of this comes as the two substates, A and B, the first two. Let's see. Infinite consciousness and infinite unconsciousness. And these seem to be in stark contradiction to each other. How can they arise concurrently, and how can they be part of the same thing? So that's where he speaks to this point here. Do we have someone? Anyone else want to read? Jeff, are you insurgent? Are you feeling insurgent at the moment?
Hence, the infinite insurge of the infinite original whim and its consequent infinite repercussions are in reality affected in the state two of God and beyond state. At the instant when the infinite original whim surged and God had the infinite original urge to know as who am I, the infinite uniformity of the infinite insurge of the whim spontaneously made manifest both the latent infinite consciousness and the latent infinite unconsciousness of God simultaneously in the original beyond state of God, who is nevertheless eternally in the most original beyond beyond state.
So now this distinction between the infinite consciousness and the infinite unconsciousness is where the entire story comes from. Out of the infinite unconsciousness, the drop wants to become conscious. It's because the drop is infinitely unconscious that it asks, who am I? It doesn't know. It's unconscious. And the whole journey is to go from the infinite unconsciousness to the infinite consciousness. So he's here explaining how it is that these two arise out of this self-same whim. And now here he gives this marvelous analogy, which I think is one of the great analogies.
This spontaneous manifestation of the latent infinite consciousness and infinite unconsciousness simultaneously is beyond the grasp of human intellect to understand and digest. It is indeed a paradox of the realm of reality, and it defeats all human understanding. How could God gain spontaneously his own infinite consciousness and his infinite unconsciousness simultaneously? Maya Baba, while explaining this, declared that this is a fact, and it is of the realm of reality, and it can never be understood or grasped by the mind. It is only to be realized on realizing the reality. At the same time, in order that we may get at least some concept of this fact effected in reality, and that we may not take it as a mere paradoxical mystery, May Baba made us understand this apparent paradox through the example of a child in a mother's womb.
Okay, so here's the analogy now.
When the mother conceives, the child is under development in the mother's womb. And as soon as the development reaches a stage when, along with other developments, the eyes of the child are fully molded, the child gains the faculties of seeing and not seeing simultaneously, irrespective of whether the child at birth sees or does not see. The very fact that the eyes have been molded in the womb of his mother gives to the child the dual aspect of his own eyes.
Do you get the idea here? When you have eyes, the question arises of seeing and not seeing at the same moment. At the same instant, you can see and you cannot see. Whether you open your eyes and see or close your eyes and don't see, either way, that dichotomy only came about when the eyes were developed. Before, it wasn't even there. So in the beyond, beyond state, there'd be no question of being conscious or unconscious. That's why he says it's neither conscious nor unconscious. But in the beyond state, both arise, both emerge at the same instant. I think it's an incredible figure for that. I'm going to keep going with this paragraph.
In the eyes, as soon as they are developed, the faculty of seeing and not seeing is simultaneously contained. When the child opens his eyes, he will see. When he closes his eyes, he will not see. The fact still holds good that no sooner were the eyes developed than there was contained in them the dual faculty of seeing and not seeing simultaneously. Similarly, with the insurge of the original infinite whim in God, both the infinite consciousness and unconsciousness, latent in God, were manifested simultaneously, which, to the limited mind, appears paradoxical.
Okay, so that is explaining how these two, A and B, emerge simultaneously in the beyond state of God. Now here's a question that Baba doesn't speak to, and I'll just put it up here. Does C emerge at the same time? What do you think, Tian? Does it come up at the same time?
That's after the evolution, the incarnation.
But there is no after. It's eternal.
Eternity.
It's not implied by, A and B are implied by asking. Like by asking the question, you both cannot know and know.
Yeah.
So C is not necessarily implied, but it'll magically appear because the whole mechanism of evolution will have happened and got back there before you know it.
Well, the C is in fact not separated from the B, because the C is the is man realizing the state of B. Baba put a separate state of C. Because when you become God, man God, you realize the B state. Then Baba somehow put a C state.
What a lot of people in the B state never do go to the C state. They just realize self.
Oh, I see.
Isn't it, something to do with time? Because didn't Baba say that at the moment of creation, simultaneously, virtually, that it happens?
Yeah.
But just we experience it as linear and time bound.
But
it happens at the same moment.
Yes.
Could it be that someone in C, he or she actually knows A and B at the same time, and that's why they're both conscious of the real and of the nothing, the nothing being the unconscious in a sense. Do you know what I mean? So it's sort of like A and B appear, and magically someone who knows both of those places also appears.
That implication could be there. C wouldn't have anything to know of creation yet until all of this had
Yeah, but there is no one. When you're at sea, there's no one till. There's like, it's all magically there.
By the way, what is sea? Just to remind you. You guys remember what sea is? A is infinite unconsciousness. B is infinite consciousness, God's infinite consciousness of self. And C is what?
Of
the created universe, So people in Bhakabhila, the Jivamuktis and the Sadhguru,
somewhere above also says, in fact, the whole state of fourth, fifth, third, seventh, no, sorry, sixth, fifth, they all happen in state two of God.
Two, I
mean. Yeah, infinite unconsciousness.
Yeah, so that speaks
yeah.
to what
the
I was saying.
The whole thing happens.
In 2A, you mean?
Yes.
In 2A. All of this is an outcome of 2A, God's infinite
also
unconsciousness.
Also happens within. Because we are dreaming, we are creating our minds.
So there's a little bit about the beyond state. Anyone want to bring up anything more about this?
So, with that state C, it could have been there and it's not realised until the avatar, the first time round, gets there.
It would seem that state C would come into its bloom as creation did.
Yeah.
It would be
like
more and more. But I would
only on the other side.
Yeah. I would think, though, that from the very beginning, from the moment that creation starts, the awareness of it in this God state would also be there.
Mm-hmm. There's a more simple and clear, I feel, description of the whole heaven and nothing and everything, the mischievous chicken story. Father says something like this: when the first question asked by God, who am I, when the whim happens, with that question, immediately the indivisible state of God is split up into two states. One is the infinite unconsciousness state, the other is infinite consciousness, which is Paramatma, God conscious. And Paramatma immediately answered his own question, I'm God. But that's only the impersonal God who answered. So God himself has to take form through evolution and reincarnation and involution to become man-God, to realize the second state. So this whole evolution happens within the state A of beyond state of God, infinite unconsciousness. So that I feel that's a kind of less, you know, convulsions of the mind of man, isn't it? It's
here's the description of this in Beams from the Spiritual Panorama on the very same point. A very nice discussion. We have a reader of this. Anybody? Jeanette, you want? Are you willing to come down from the 10th state?
Yeah, okay. The first whim to know instantaneously implies a duality, an apparent differentiation, not amounting to a breaking up, into two separate aspects, both of which are infinite as aspects of the infinite. The first aspect is that of infinite consciousness, and the second aspect is that of infinite unconsciousness. The duality strives to overcome itself and to restore the apparently lost unity. The infinite unconsciousness tries to unite with infinite consciousness. Both aspects are precipitated by the whim. This whim of the infinite is in a way comparable to an infinite question, calling forth an infinite answer.
Yeah, isn't that keep going.
With the infinite question, there arises also the infinite answer. The infinite question is infinite unconsciousness.
Right, because who am I? That's because unconsciousness is there. I don't know. In infinite intelligence, Baba calls this knowledge knowing that it does not know. That is knowledge knowing ignorance. That is knowledge experiencing ignorance.
The infinite answer is infinite consciousness. But the infinite question and the infinite answer do not simply annul each other and relapse into the original unity of the beyond. These two aspects have now descended.
Let's see.
Into the primal duality, which can resolve itself only by fulfilling the entire game of duality and not by any shortcut. The infinite unconsciousness cannot overlap on infinite consciousness. Such coalescence is impossible.
Okay, so now the whole journey has to follow as you go from infinite unconsciousness to infinite consciousness.
Can I tell a little story? Sam Saunders passed away last year, a very much beloved community. He said he went to a bookshop and then this book fell open, infinite consciousness overlap, infinite unconsciousness. That's it. The one who wrote it must know. So that line made Sam a Baba follower.
So what that passage just talked about was 2A and 2B. It wasn't called that in beams, but that's what it was. Infinite unconscious, infinite consciousness. And the whole journey is from here to there. The entire creation is arisen to cross that gap between those two aspects. State two. So this section on the beyond state of God is really an important and pretty amazing discussion. We've only read some of it. You can see the great philosophers will, you know, be studying this for centuries to come. Now the third state of God is actually out of the sequence in a certain way, because the dropped soul does not become this. I wish I could flash concurrently some of those images, like a Jamshed's eye. Remember Jamshed's eye? Where Jamshed is the creator, creates the universe. And that's a whole separate function. And Ishwar just goes on doing that and doesn't go through the journey of the soul, just stuck there, poor fellow. It's the ultimate workaholic spends all 24/7 creating, preserving, destroying the universe completely selflessly, as far as I can see. So if any of the avatars about workers start complaining about how overworked you are, just compare yourself to Ishwar and think how easy you got it.
So this is, it's like the creative act, like if you were painting or something.
Right.
Create it, it's preserved, and you destroy it to recreate it,
right,
and sustain it, and it's, you know, like that.
Yeah, yeah.
It's the same thing, creating it, preserving it, and then destroying it to recreate it in a different way.
Yes, in each of those, the others are inherent. When you create, you would create in the presumption that you're going to preserve what you create.
Yeah.
And when you preserve, you do so against the eventuality of it's being destroyed sooner or later.
Yeah.
So they're all part, they're all the same aspect of God, actually. They're one state of God, not three. Three aspects of one state of God. And we were talking last weekend about how Baba describes this in the course of chapter 8 as the present as we experience. It is actually our past being represented to us as if it were the present. What we see as the present at this moment is actually our past. Well, that seems to be true in many, many ways. The whole process of creation, this is all related to creator, preserver, destroyer. That our present life as we take it to be is actually our past life. In our past life, we created all those sanskaras, and now we're living them out, actually. Baba said the same thing about the avatar. Some of you may remember this, that Meher Baba is actually Muhammad. He's living out Muhammad's advent. Remember that?
That's right. He said, now that Meher Baba has passed away, now begins the ministry of Meher Baba. All that happened up until then was the ministry of Muhammad.
And that will be the case when the next advent also.
Yeah.
So how does that fit with Baba saying that his sanskaras are unbinding and all that stuff? Like, shouldn't everything he does just has no tie backs? If you know
not on him, but on the world.
Yeah. His work in the world.
I think Baba said more like, when he was Muhammad, he mapped out the spiritual map for this next few hundred years. We are just living that. I don't know whether he said Meher Baba was living out Muhammad,
I remember Eric saying Baba had said that.
He did.
He does it, he would bring up from time to time.
Now begins the ministry of Maya Baba.
Yeah.
All and that happened up until then was planned by Muhammad.
Yeah, that's the word planned by Muhammad.
But it's actually, it was more than just planned. It's actually like living out.
It's
more than that. Mm-hmm. And it's actually exactly analogous to our own lifetimes where we're doing this. I'm living out my past lifetime.
Mm.
And my lifetime as Ward, I'll live out my next birth.
Mm.
You know, because that's what we're constantly doing. We're living the past.
Mm.
We keep living the past. We can't live the present.
Mm.
That's
depression, isn't it?
And this is, yeah, it is. And this is, I feel, I don't know how, what my thought is exactly, but God speaks. Baba's technique of explaining things is very related to this, because constantly he'll get to a topic, and then he'll start with how you got there. Again and again, when he gets in chapter 4 to human form and reincarnation, by God, the first three pages of it are recapitulating the evolution of consciousness that got you to human form. And there are a lot of examples of this where he's, okay, and here in the fourth state of God, the next one after this, which is the embodied soul, what does Baba do? He spends the first three pages retelling the story of the creation of the universe that gets to the point of the embodied soul. Now, it's not like Nihar Baba had a fetish on this, and he always did this. No, I don't find that to be characteristic of his explanations in general, but they're very characteristic of his explanations when God speaks. And they're also very related to the style of God speaks, which is constantly reaching back to the last sentence and carrying forward a lot of its verbiage and performing his new operation on it. That's, the style is endlessly like that. If we spent time on the style, I could show you exactly what I mean. It's like, often they'll say stylistically, the first part of the sentence typically recapitulates the previous sentence, and the second part of the sentence performs some kind of a transformation on it.
Is it a variation on the previous thing? He just keeps doing a variation on it.
He'll bring, even a lot of times, he's just playing a lot of the verbiage, and he'll repeat it at great length, and then he'll do something new on it.
So he's sort of recapitulating that in the structure of the writing, exactly what we were just talking about.
Exactly.
In terms of the
interconnectedness. That's what it looks like to me.
I have a question about this reliving our past life.
Yeah.
If that's the case, then there's absolute determinism. There's nothing we can do. So how does the free will come in?
We're just going to have another. We have to have another weekend because we're stuck now. We're stuck in determinism. It's a disastrous end to the 2 weekends.
Isn't it somewhere said that, so what you do, your scars play out in what will happen, but how you respond to what will happen is what then moves you. You know, so your free will isn't how you respond. So you can either be kicked, dragging, and screaming to God, or you can go dancing. But the same thing, you're going on the same track, because there's the track that's laid down. It's just how you travel.
Yeah. We wake up each morning, we come from that beyond state, we wake up each morning into the lives we've already had, and into our past, but we are not that. That's where there's hope.
Mm-hmm.
It's already, yeah. I mean,
we're going to have future sessions. I'm going to sort of push this along because it's a very, very interesting question. Actually,
keep doing what you're doing without expectation of a result.
So
you just keep doing, you don't know what the result is going to be.
Well, we do, because the fact that we are
God is already. Okay, let's get back to the third.
That's an important question.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it'd be worthwhile. Actually, I have a whole big presentation on this topic. There are many aspects. Free will and determinism. Baba lovers really want to talk about this.
Oh, no.
It's
a terrible topic.
Except for John.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, here we're getting back to the third. We'll just read little bits of this because we've explored it before. One of the things Baba does is bring a lot of the language of Sufism and Vedanta to it. Do we have a reader of this? John, how about you? Since this will get you away from free will and determinism. Yeah. It's a superior topic.
So, the three attributes, the first one?
Yeah, the state three.
All right. God is emanator, sustainer, and dissolver. In this state, God brings into play three principal attributes.
Sifat, we just mentioned the word earlier, guna. Yeah. Sorry, I can't raise it. I don't think I can. No, I can't. Sorry.
Of emanating, sustaining, and dissolving. This three-in-one state corresponds to the trinity of Vedanta, Brahma, creator, Vishnu, preserver, and Mahesh, destroyer. The Sufi synonyms of which are the terms Afridgar, Parvardigar, and Fanakar.
So our prayer goes, O Parvardigar, the preserver and protector. We talked about this before, how we pray to the preserver of that trinity. I don't know these others, Afridgar and Fana. Well, Fana, actually, for the word Fana.
Solova.
Yeah.
It's Sufi.
Yeah. Yeah. Can you read that?
The three attributes of God are expressed through the three archangels. Israfil, the angel who creates life. Michael, the angel who sustains life. And Israel, the angel who destroys life.
So that's interesting, isn't it?
What's that? What is that?
It sounds like the Islamic version of those names which also appear in Judaism to me. Mm-hmm. But I'm not I haven't really looked these things up. Mm-hmm. So now on the next page he says a bit about the inevitable interlinking of these things. You see, here he goes back to the infinite urge to know. Again, it's this thing of going back and coming to the present topic from what preceded it. In this case, the second state of God and all of that. But where does he... Sorry. Okay. Let's start right here.
Well, God...
Yeah.
To have gained the attribute of emanator, he obviously becomes the creator of creation. And as in his state three... It then follows most naturally that when God creates, he must spontaneously also sustain what he creates. He then obviously becomes also the preserver of creation, as in his state three. And in the very act of preserving what is created, God also simultaneously establishes the inevitable dissolution or destruction of creation. Preservation would be meaningless if dissolution or destruction were not anticipated. Accordingly, God obviously becomes also the dissolver or destroyer of creation, as in state two. Three. State three of God is that state in which God becomes the creator and simultaneously remains the sustainer or preserver and dissolver or destroyer of his own creation. At one and the same time, God thus becomes creator, preserver, and destroyer in state three.
Most logical.
Yeah, so that's a very clear statement of how these are three aspects of one single state.
Yeah.
The in Hinduism, the god Dattatreya is creator Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh, three heads like that. Actually, Narayan Maharaj was a devotee. Baba, one of Baba's five perfect masters, was a devotee of Dattatreya. Mm. So now. Here, what can be a little bit of this too, John?
Mahababa has told us that there is no creation in the literal sense of the word. What we call creation is a manifestation of countless forms of the nothing. This nothing is really no thing, but it exists in its own field of illusion. It cannot be denied, but it is not beyond the everything that is God. Although the everything includes this nothing, the nothing never does and never can include or mean the everything. The Almighty alone is the everything, including the nothing. And before creation manifested itself, there was literally and absolutely no thing but the Almighty as the everything.
So here again, right in discussing Creator, Preserver, Destroyer, he makes emphatically the point that really speaking, creation never happens. Yeah.
With the current technology to have holographic things, the holograph really captures this. The holograph looks like something, but it's nothing.
That infinite intelligence, the same idea was expressed, where the infinite imagination is created as the universes which we live in and experience, but they really don't exist. They've never happened. And infinite intelligence like this, repeatedly, Baba makes the point, this never happened. Nothing ever got created. It's all purely imaginary. So creation is like, with scare quotes around it, it's something that is purely within the domain of imagination. And this state of God, Baba says in Infinite Intelligence, stands at God's left hand, at the Sadhguru's left hand, or I suppose, updating that the avatar's left hand. The avatar, he says Sadhguru, so I'll stick with that. The Sadhguru has in his right hand Parameshwar, through which God gives the realization of God, or on a lower level than that, just spiritual things. And in his left hand is Ishwar, through which the perfect master gives worldly things. And Ishwar is the state of God, infinitely conscious of the universe, but not conscious of himself as God. But if you go to the Sadhguru himself, he gives himself. That's what he says there. So Ishwar is at the left hand of God. Now the next state of God is the embodied soul. And lo and behold, this becomes one of the major sections of the 10 states of God. If you want to study the creation, that whole creation narrative, we went into it yesterday bringing in Pranakash and the stuff from the 1920s. But if you want to read where God speaks, treats it, there are three major places. One out of the 10 parts or 10 chapters, one is at the beginning of part two. It begins with the infinite urge. First several pages there discuss the whim, and the creation of the universe. The second is the beginning of part eight, the beginning of the second pass through the divine theme. And there's an extensive treatment of the everything and the nothing, the whim, the lahar, the om point, all those things. And the third is not at the beginning of the 10 states of God, but in this presentation of the embodied soul. Baba explains the embodied soul, again, by going back and explaining where it came from. Yeah,
Jenny? Right to an end, people just need to be careful as they're leaving. It's getting very boggy. I'll have to go around all the boggy part.
Okay. Now. Okay, I think I'm not going to take the time to go through this, because we've actually covered this in various forms. But notice how, imagine an infinite unconscious God in state A before the creation came into as an infinite ocean and then there's a puff of wind. So Baba returns to this whole mythos of the ocean and the wind surging and bubbles coming into existence. And it's when the bubble comes into existence that is the embodied soul. And as we discussed earlier, it would seem that the purpose of this section is to enunciate the principle of the embodied soul, which is the fourth state. The fifth state, evolution, the sixth, reincarnation, the seventh, advancement through the planes, you still got the embodied soul. But here he's explaining what it is and how it came into existence out of this infinite ocean to begin with. At the end of this section, he gives some indications. Let's see what this is all about. Remember this. Okay, here we have the first urge again. You can see here the experience of contrariety. Remember that? The topic of contrariety. When the embodied soul, when the Atma first becomes embodied as the first impression in stone form, it experiences contrariety, contrariness, for the first time. Within the unity of God, there would be no opposites, no possibility of having that experience. But when the soul experiences itself as most finite and most limited, those are the opposite of the actual real state of the soul, which is unlimited and infinite. And thus it experiences the tension of contrariety. And out of that comes an eruption. And this, here we have the eruption. There occurred a sort of eruption, disrupting the indivisible poise and unconscious tranquility of the infinite soul with a recoil or tremendous shock. And again, this sounds to me, what do you think, Paul? I'm going to be a Big Bang guy. This sounds like the Big Bang to me.
Yeah, but it's not gross yet. The Big Bang is fundamentally
gross. No, it's
gross.
It's gross. This is gross, man. It's the most finite impression.
Yeah. No, but see, it's talking about those subtle gaseous forms and all that. That's not gross.
No, it's not gross.
This is before.
No, this is gross. It's the most finite, most gross impression.
Yeah.
But they're unconscious subtle.
Yeah, I think when he says most gross here, I mean, I know that I'm
not even gross.
Using the words
earlier in earlier discussions of this, it's very clearly gross.
Yeah, I don't know. I've always took the most gross. It's the equivalent of saying, you know, sometimes he says stone is the first form, and then other times he says, oh no, there's stuff before that, and there's the subtle.
Actually, you know, this business of the subtle gases, there it does seem to be a contradiction here because he calls them subtle gases in some places, but in other places he says it's actually most fine. In fact, it comes up here, and he says not subtle but fine. So there's some question about all of that. Okay, well, the big Bang is still in doubt.
I don't know if you can bring
the Big Bang.
I don't think he means gross.
No, most finite first impression.
But yeah, except I'm using the words how I want them to fit my theory, so I'm open to criticism.
Well, in a way, stone starts in some ways as fire. Doesn't it?
What's that?
Whirly. Remember he went back and was talking about nebula?
Yeah.
And this whirling fire, which then consolidates into stone. What are planets? The stone would still fire the central and the suns.
But embodiment begins before it consolidates into stone, even in that account it does.
It's like that nebula.
It's whatever that is. Yeah, that would seem to be the first embodiments. Yeah.
Nebula means cloud, doesn't it?
Well, it generally does, but there's that strange usage that Baba gave to it in how it all happened, where it seems to be infinitely thin and gross at the same time. So it's rather puzzling usage, what he means, but it's not really very clear. But here he starts to, here we have his description of the gaseous forms in God's speaks. Let's read this. We have a reader. Anyone in a gaseous mood? Life is a gas. Okay, Chris perks up.
From the first medium, yeah. We joke today. This first medium adopted by God in the state form, God as embodied soul, is the first form which, although it is gross, yet it is so inconceivably, infinitely finite, that it cannot even be considered as gross. It is so very infinitely shapeless and substanceless, matterless and formless, that it cannot lead one even to imagine that it is gross. Yet this form is the very first gross form that emerges simultaneously, as if in three prongs, as the first three of the foremost seven gas-like forms.
Now this is very interesting, the three prongs, and I simply don't know what this means. Do any of you have an idea of this? The three prongs is the first three gaseous forms, apparently.
Are they talking about that illustration where it has three...
Which illustration?
The chart, and it's two sides of God's chart.
The, how to fork out. Three prongs.
It rings a bell somehow, but I can't figure out what to associate. It seems like it's... I think this is a significant reference, the three prongs. But to work out what it connects with would be...
I wonder if it has anything to do with the Taoist description of the Tao gave birth to one to two, two to three. From the three, the mirror things have formed.
This whole description, too, of these forms, I did do a bit of reading in quantum, where matter has just dissolved away completely, and it seems to have become probabilities, actually, and the realization of probabilities, that waves and particles are not, don't have the substance that they seem to have once in physics. And it seems like Baba is talking in this kind of a realm of things now. About the very bases of matter. Again, it'd be wonderful if we had somebody who really knew about physics. Yeah, did you want to?
If you read down, it almost looks like he's interchanging the word prongs with forms.
Yeah. Yes, he is. There are definitely three forms. Yeah, these are the first three forms of gas. Yeah, let's keep reading. Chris, you want to take this on? Gas, the prongs.
So is this before prana and akash?
I think this is after.
Yeah.
Prana and Akash have clashed, or else you couldn't have any forms at all. That's what creates forms.
If a description of these first three gas-like forms could ever be attempted, they could only be described from the standpoint of density, the first having infinitely negligible density, then the second the next stage negligible density, and in the third stage as having the first traces of density. These first three forms have no evolution. The next three forms may come within the scope of our imagination and may be described as semi-gaseous and semi-material forms. Evolution begins with the fourth gas-like form.
So isn't that interesting? These first three forms are prior to evolution.
Mm.
Yeah.
Mm.
I guess they're just stuck there forever. What are they made of? It's rather mysterious. So here, evolution begins with the fourth out of seven. Yeah.
And finally, there is the seventh gas-like form of the series of seven foremost gas-like forms, which is hydrogen, and which may be said to include the electron. It should be noted well that the first six gas-like gross forms bear no resemblance to the various gases, such as hydrogen, nitrogen, and so forth. They are much, much finer, not subtler. This is in no way to be connected with any form or object of the subtle world, because these forms are solely of the gross world.
Yeah, so this is a strong statement about these gaseous forms.
They're much, much finer than those with which the scientists of the age are well conversant.
Okay, so this is back in the 1950s.
Well, do you think at this point there is subtle forms, or the subtle forms, it just skips straight to gross? Do you know what I mean? Like, is there mental stuff that then makes subtle stuff that then makes this, and he's just skipped that whole bit? Or does it just skip straight to gross? And
I mean, there would have to be a descent through the mental and subtle to get to.
But you'd have to say this implies that there's not. Like if you read this on...
Well, he hasn't talked about it as such.
Mm.
But there, it would have to be implicitly there.
He doesn't, Prabhupada doesn't talk about it here, but he does in Nothing and Everything. Prabhupada, Devolution.
Mm. There have to be a descent for those things to get
yes,
here at all.
Yes.
Mm.
Because the mental it gives rise to the subtle, and the subtle gives rise to the gross.
Well,
there's an awful lot here that Baba just gives indications of and doesn't fully.
But those three prongs, it does seem to riff. There may be an illustration with it somewhere.
I have a feeling that we're going to figure that one out at some point.
Okay.
And the other two problems might be proto-mental and proto-subtle.
Could be.
Go along with the...
That's one trinity that could be reflected there. It's possible.
I don't put that...
Now, since our time is almost ended, I'm just...
But yeah, I remember.
The... Actually, Baba doesn't have a whole lot to say in his sections on reincarnation or his sections on involution that we haven't already seen. And we've already said something about these. But I wanted to bring up the subject of the four journeys, which is the article in the Everything and the Nothing. Is actually first explained in God Speaks. It's talked about as such in chapter 8. We didn't go into it then because there are other things we're talking about. You may remember in Jesus Gathering, actually, Francis was up there giving. They had a chart. We have a nice photograph of that, in fact, of the chart of the four journeys. And Baba explained it before that group. And I've always thought it's very curious that that was the public discourse that Baba chose to give at the East Coast Gathering.
Mm-hmm.
And I wonder why that would be. But here, we can say what the four journeys are. They're explained in chapter 8. He even calls it the first journey, the second journey. He even calls it that. But the first journey is from human form. I had always thought it was from the beginning of evolution, the whim under the whim, up to the final philosophy state. It's not. The first journey begins with human form, and it's the journey through evolution up to the eighth state of God, the realization of God, the I am God state. And at the end of the first journey, you become a mukti, a mukta, or else in the state of Nirvikalpa Samadhi, the realization of God. Cha-Cha would have completed the first journey. The second journey is from the eighth state of God to the ninth, where you go from the I am God state down to the re-experiencing of Bhakavila, of the universe. You're conscious of the universe again. That's the second journey. The third journey is from the ninth state of God to the tenth. And that is completed. Everybody completes the first journey, and most people, that's it. They're not into traveling on at all. But a few go to Bhakavila of the ninth state of God as a Paramahansa or as a Jivanmukta. A Paramahansa is sometimes conscious of the universe and sometimes not. And a Jivanmukta is all the time conscious of the universe. But they don't have a duty. They don't have a circle. They don't have a job. They just get to watch. The third journey is completed by perfect masters, and it is the assumption of a duty and living the life of God within creation. And the fourth journey is after a perfect master dies, they go back to here, to the eighth state of God. In fact, Baba said that Jivanmuktas, perfect masters, and the avatar retire to this state of God after death, which has given rise to a question in the Baba world a year or two ago. So that means that Baba is unconscious of us all and doesn't love us anymore because he's sleeping. He's back in the eighth state of God. So that conclusion will never be acceptable to Baba's lovers, and they'll find out some way or another of rejecting it.
So what's your response to that question, or to that statement?
Well, I'm a Baba lover when it comes down to the bottom of it, and I just won't buy it. Somehow I'll find a way of...
I asked Bhaji, Acharya Bhaji, he said, once you become conscious God, you'll never become unconscious. So, that's it.
No, but the eighth state of God is conscious. They're just not conscious of the creation.
Baba is conscious as Dharmakaya at the moment. He's conscious as infinite life. He's never unconscious. His own body is not there. His infinite consciousness cannot be unconscious.
Actually, just go on the marrow bed.
Now, this is the final, very famous conclusion. And I'm going to put this word up here because I think it has a relationship to this rhetorical term. It's the avatar's version of this, a palinode. A very famous palinode, at least in my former sphere of work, was a Chaucer at the end of the Canterbury Tales. Chaucer says, I'm really, really sorry for having written a whole bunch of tales here that were bawdy, and that was all my fault. But anything that's good here is thanks to our Lord Jesus Christ. Please forgive me. And it's at the end of it, a work you retract it, so to speak. Well, of course, Baba's not retracting it, but there is something like that here because he's been giving all these explanations of everything, and now it's as if he pulls it back and says, you can never understand this. So I think there's a relationship to this form. So I call it Baba's palinode. So,
what do you call it? Deconstruction.
Deconstruction, yeah.
Postmodernism.
I actually don't call it deconstruction. I don't think it's that.
I mean, it's classic Baba, though. He does that all the time. It's always like, oh, yeah, if you can't do that, do this. And if you can't do that, here's something else you can try. You know.
All right, Paul, so why don't you read this out to us? Why don't you close the door?
God cannot be explained. He cannot be argued about. He cannot be theorized, nor can he be discussed or understood. God can only be lived. Nevertheless, all that is said here and explained about God to appease the intellectual convulsions of the mind of man still lacks many more words and further explanations, because the truth is that the reality must be realized and the divinity of God must be attained and lived. To understand the infinite eternal reality is not the goal of individualized beings in the illusion of creation, because the reality can never be understood. It is to be realized by conscious experience. Therefore, the goal is to realize the reality and attain the I am God state in human form.
Yeah, magnificent statement of what the purpose of all this is, to realize it, not to understand it.
That's right.
Okay, well, it's 20:05, so what maybe...
You could have just read
that
at the beginning.
What's that? You read at the beginning, you could have scared yourself 2 weekends in agony. Okay, that'll be the solution next time. Okay, well, thank you all so much.
Thank you.